welcome to the Two Pages Project, the newest part of the Coil Entertainment Network. I'm your host, Rob Steele. If you'd like to become a published author, stay tuned after the show for a vast majority of the details. But let's get right to this week's story. And this week we have a magical coming-of-age story from author Jan Perry called Earthwalking. If it did not stop raining soon, Princess Thelma was just going to go out and get wet anyway. Everyone told her princesses could not play in the rain, but she was determined to go out and play with her new rocks. They arrived yesterday, a 16th birthday present from her uncle, and were sitting outside her windows, looking so inviting. Her uncle discovered the rocks on the planet with the funny-sounding name. They changed color and shape depending on the weather. At the moment, they were brilliant cyan, and long and sleek and looked perfect for lying on with a book. Earlier today, before the rain, they were a rich cinnamon and crackly and bumpy. They had beckoned her to come climb. Then it started to rain, and she couldn't leave the castle. Her mom called her.
It must be lunchtime.
She pushed the door open and stepped onto the mover. She wanted to run, but that wasn't proper. Royalty had to use movers so that their feet wouldn't get dirty.
What a bunch of foolishness,
she thought as she was whisked away to the dining area. She took her place at the center of the arena with her parents and sister and two brothers. As soon as they were seated, the normal pandemonium broke out. Food was served, dancers danced, jugglers juggled. Weightless wonders flew around the room doing flips and turns. The newest animals from the same planet as her rocks were on paraded by, and amazing fireworks were going off in the globe in front of the table. Princess Thelma decided long ago that the reason for all the diversions during the meals was because the cook was terrible. The food always tasted bland and mushy. Either way, having diversions while she ate was helpful. She pushed the bronze button that caused the barrier to surround her family so they could hear each other talk. She wanted to ask her parents, Queen Bethany and King Jeffers, to request that they proclaim the right of earthwalking for her for a period of 1 year. She put forth her argument, and her sister and brothers looked at her dumbfounded. Her parents rolled their eyes.
Thelma, dearest, how can we allow this? If your feet get dirty and someone recognizes you, crops would fail, and the ships to the outer planets would have to boycott us for the remainder of the year to assure no contamination of our family.
I was reading in the library.
Thelma started, and this time all the eyes of the room rolled in unison. Thelma was the reader and always brought disturbing and odd little pieces of archaic information to the meals. It did distract them from the food, but it also wearied everyone. Thelma continued undaunted.
I found an article from 2015 that described how physical contact with the Earth helps people center themselves and become happier.
What does center themselves mean? Were they lopsided?
Asked her older brother Jason. Sometimes she felt true terror when she thought about the kingdom falling to him when her parents died. He was so literal. It drove her crazy.
No, they were not lopsided, Jason. It means they could hear their hearts talk better when they walked barefoot.
That makes no sense. Taking off your shoes has nothing to do with the acuity of one's hearing. That is a fact,
Jason said and removed himself from the barrier. The other brother and sister were now engrossed in the fireworks, which served Thelma just fine.
Mother, Father, I'm not happy, and I haven't been for many months now. I want to be a strong princess, and to do my job in leading this planet as my time comes to do that. Right now, however, I'm consumed with sadness. I can't learn my lessons in planetary doctrine or the processes of travel projection. I believe if I could have 1 year of walking on Earth, I could come back stronger and be able to fulfill my role for the family in this planet.
She had rehearsed this for a long while. It was hard to make wanting to play in the rain sound like a crucial step in becoming a planetary leader. Her mother sat motionless for several moments. She glanced at her husband. He nodded almost imperceptibly. Queen Bethany straightened more, if that were even possible. Then she said,
"You have put your case forth with honesty and fervor. We grant your wish with the following conditions. You must never be recognized as Princess Thelma. You must return immediately anytime the signal is shown, and you must speak only to women and girls. Can you accept these conditions?"
"You've got to be kidding me,"
thought Thelma.
"I can accept any condition to escape and play in the rain and climb on rocks and swim in the lake. The victory is at hand."
Her heart was pounding so hard she was sure everyone could see it.
"They are difficult conditions, but I will accept them. When will this right be proclaimed, and will I need to return?"
"You must leave before midday tomorrow and return in exactly 259 days. You have our blessings and our love. We hope you will find your center and your happiness,"
her father said as he rose, the signal for all of them to leave the eating arena. As quickly as the chaos in the arena started, it was over. Thelma could have gotten to her room without touching the floor without the mover, she was so excited.
"Tomorrow at midday my quest begins. I wonder what dirt feels like. I wonder what I should take with me."
She had dreamed about this day for years. She never thought it could happen. She had no plan. She recognized that was not good. When she got to her room, she started making lists of what she would need. Clothes, food, books, tools, a horse. In the midst of her list-making, her father knocked on her door and entered.
"I see you are making lists for your earthwalking. I wanted to give you this for your time away."
He handed her a small wooden box that looked quite plain.
"Thank you, Father. May I open it now?"
Thelma opened the box and found three packets of papers. One was a description of how to make a shoe. The second was a list of plants never to eat from the wild. And the third was a well-worn notebook with the handwritten title of Earthwalking 101. Thelma looked up at her father.
"You did an earthwalk, Father?"
"No, your mother did. They are three of her prized possessions. She asked me to give them to you."
"I must go talk to her."
"No, I am representing all of the family this evening. You will leave tomorrow with no goodbyes from the rest of the family. The kitchen staff has been given instructions to provide you with some basic things you will need. I want you to know that we all love you and wish you well and look forward to seeing who returns in 259 days.
Her father kissed her on her forehead and left. Thelma sat stunned. She had not expected this sense of importance from her parents, nor the sense of foreboding she was feeling. She began to wonder if playing with those new rocks was what this was all about. She looked in the box and picked up the instructions on making a shoe.
"What is a shoe?"
By morning, she had made something that looked roughly like what was in the pictures. The instructions strongly encouraged her, or whoever this was written for, it looked very old, to have shoes before they left home. It was also said not to put them on until well away from home, at least 2 hours. She put her shoes, clothes, and other items in her carrier. It followed her as she walked to the kitchen to get whatever they had prepared for her. There was a box with her name on it, but no one was in the kitchen. The note said that she should leave promptly before the kitchen staff returned. She put the box in her carrier and headed out the door. She was very pleased that she had the carrier. All of the things she had packed would have been too heavy for her to carry for long. She walked into the surrounding forest. After a couple of hours, she found a place to stop. She sat on a rock and got out her shoes with the instructions on how to wear them. Her feet were sore from the rough path. She hoped that the shoes might help that. She also saw that the kitchen staff had packed her a water flask and something labeled a traveling biscuit. She sipped on the water and ate a biscuit. Wait, the biscuit was crunchy and slightly sweet. It wasn't mushy and it wasn't bland. It was delicious.
Why did they not have these in the castle?
She walked another few hours and came to a town. She pulled her cap low on her head. She had meant to cut her hair, but she did not have the time after she made her shoe last night. The shoe was actually working quite well. That gift from her mother was much appreciated. She went to a park to sit and think about her next dilemma. Finding a place to sleep for the night. She was sitting on a bench, taking the town in and pondering. A woman, walking a strange animal, sat on the bench beside her.
How are you this gorgeous day?
I'm doing well, and yes, it is a gorgeous day.
You're new to town. Are you going to be here long?
My plans are a bit uncertain, but I expect I'll be here for a couple days, maybe a little longer.
Suddenly, Thelma realized she needed a story and a name. She needed a reason to be here and something for people to call her. She started looking around to get ideas while trying not to look panicked.
My name is Grace, and I live down the road about 5 minutes. You have arrived at our festival. We have lots of musicians and actors and vendors in town, and I'm afraid that the hotels will be full. Do you have a place to stay?
She asked with concern in her face.
The festival sounds lovely.
She spied a beautiful lily in the garden in the park.
My name is Lily, and I don't know about the festival and did not make reservations. Do you have any suggestions?
My sister and I live together, and we have a small shelter that guests stay in at times. It isn't fancy, but it has all the basics. You would be welcome there for a few days until your plans settle in.
That would be wonderful.
Grace seemed like a good person, and living with her sister, it might be easy to avoid talking with men. Thelma was happy to see she thought to bring some money and some things she could sell in case she needed more money.
And you must let me pay you some rent.
That would be fine, Lily. Shall we head on to the house? Maybe we can find something for supper.
The two women and the strange animal headed down the road. In 5 minutes, they were at the gate of a captivating tiny home. Grace took Thelma inside and showed off her home. She was obviously proud of it.
The place where you will be staying is where we lived while we built this place.
You built this?
It was a gorgeous small building that had all the hallmarks of a cozy home.
My sister and I did. Our parents wanted boys and got us, so they taught us all the building trades. That is how we earn our living. Building has been very good to us. Joy will be home shortly. She's finishing up a job on the south side of town.
Joy is your sister?
Yes, she's not quite as pleasant as her name suggests, but we love each other and work well together. You will meet her soon. Let's take you to your place so you can get settled in before dinner.
They walked to the back of the yard to another little house. It wasn't as fine as the first, but it was more than serviceable.
This is enchanting, Grace.
You two are really talented. I love this.
She put her carrier on the bed in the back of the house. Grace gave her a short tour and instructions on how everything worked, and then headed back to her own house to start dinner.
I'll ring the bell when dinner's ready, and you can just head on over.
When she got back to her house, Grace gave the bell a whack with a hammer hanging next to it. No chance that Thelma would miss that.
See you soon.
She went back inside her place. Her place. She had never had her own whole place. Thelma was feeling a bit more relaxed than when she left. She put a few of her things away and sat in the chair. She opened her box and got out the booklet. Earthwalking 101. She had not had time to read any of it. The first words were,
"They told me to trust no one, but I found that I had good instincts about who to trust, and they never let me down. My first night out was spent in a lovely tiny house with a woman named Grace and her sister Joy."
Thelma stood up, shut the book, went to the bed, sat down, and read the first words again. They still said the same thing. Thelma put the book back in the box and sat in the chair and tried to piece things together. Grace's strange little creature came in her open door and curled up at her feet and promptly fell asleep with her head on Thelma's foot. The contact was comforting.
Thelma jumped at the sound of the dinner bell.
She was deep in thoughts about her mother's words. How could this be? How could their earth walks both start by meeting identical people in places? She headed out the door, and the little creature joined her. She decided that forthrightness was the appropriate approach. She would just ask Grace at dinner.
"Good evening. You do not look as if you're rested. In fact, you look a bit agitated. Is everything okay?
I had a bit of a start as I was unpacking. I read some notes that someone gave to me for the start of my journey. They started a similar journey 20 or 30 years ago.
Grace was in the dining area where the table was full of things that Thelma had never seen before. There was a bowl of green leafy things with red and white bits of something else in it. Another bowl of mushy white stuff that did look familiar. And another plate of slices of something brownish red and juicy. Thelma wondered if this was what they ate. It certainly appeared that way. Grace sat at one end of the table and told Thelma to sit wherever she would like. About that time, another woman entered the room.
Lily, I would like you to meet my sister Joy. Joy, this is the young woman I told you about this afternoon. She will be staying with us for a while.
Welcome to our little house. We don't have company often. Excuse the simple meal.
I'm thankful that you've offered me shelter and food. The start of my journey was a bit faster than expected, and I wasn't able to make the preparations I would have liked.
Earthwalks always start faster than... Stop that! Why are you kicking me, Grace? I am speaking the truth.
I'm just learning about earthwalks. Have you had much experience with them?
Grace was obviously flustered. Joy beamed as if the question trumped Grace's kick. Thelma wondered if Grace was always trying to stop Joy from talking.
We are the first stop for all earthwalks. They seem to start roughly or too fast or with some type of problem. Our job is to facilitate a successful journey.
Joy seemed quite pleased that she had been asked about their job.
What do you mean? I thought earthwalks happened rarely and the walker was to accomplish it alone.
Right.
Right.
Joy and Grace simultaneously rolled their eyes.
No one can do anything without help from others in some way. Accomplishing things alone is a great falsehood and has been spread by people who wish to create mischief.
Joy was obviously enjoying the role of expert.
How long have you been doing this?
About 75, maybe 85 years.
Joy glared at Grace, daring her to kick her under the table again.
Wait, you can't possibly be that old. What is going on here? Am I in danger?
Thelma realized how foolish the questions were, but they came out of her mouth before she could think.
Here, eat some supper. I can tell we will be here for a long while this evening. You will feel better with a full stomach.
Grace was passing her the dish of the green stuff. Thelma felt almost as if the offer was an order. She put some of the green stuff on her plate, and then the mushy stuff, and then the sliced thing.
No more talking about earthwalks until we finish supper.
Thelma ate a forkful of the green stuff.
What is it? This is delicious. Wow, this is great, too. And what is that?
She said, pointing to the brownish-red stuff.
This is plain country folk food. Mashed potatoes, salad with tomatoes and cucumbers, and some roast beef. You look as if you've never tasted this before.
She hasn't. She's royalty, and we have to thank them for this.
Thelma's heart stopped. How did they know she was royalty? Had she just doomed her planet? She looked at Joy.
What do you mean about the royalty and thanking them for the food?
This is the way that everyone on this planet eats except for those who rule. So if you don't know what this is, you must be royalty. They eat the most horrible stuff as a sacrifice for the rest of us. By giving up this pleasure, they assure the prosperity of the planet.
I know that. This isn't my first contact, you know.
Grace's eyes were blazing.
That makes no sense. Why would they do that, and why would that even work? That just sounds like some silly old tale that someone just made up.
It's true. And to the first part of your question, we are some of the ancients. Our role is to assist those who seek. You seem to be one of those seeking.
Seeking? That sounds way too honorable. I started this so I could play in the rain and climb rocks.
Something seemed to be going seriously wrong.
What are ancients?
That is the way most quests start. Someone is bored and wants to have fun, and they find out that fun comes at a price.
Well, that's not right. What's wrong with having fun and playing? Playing in the rain or climbing on those rocks that change color and shape would make me happy. And if I did it with someone else, we would both be happy. And we might even learn that we need to help each other get over a big crack in the rock, or that when we both thought hard about or discussed some problem, we might actually come up with a solution that would work. How can someone sacrificing tasty food fix any problem? This is crazy.
Grace and Joy shimmered a bit. Thelma blinked when she saw that, but then they were solid again.
What did you two just do? What was that shimmery thing?
We were consulting with some other people. It seems that your desire to play has some interesting side effects. Does play always help you solve problems and work with others?
How should I know? I'm never allowed to play. It just seems like it would. The whole reason I'm here is that I want to see what happens when I climb and run around and get my feet dirty.
Thelma realized she was getting a bit worked up. One of the first lessons her parents taught her in planetary leadership was one should never get worked up. She took a deep breath. She was not sure what to do to undo the display of passion. She was also not sure she wanted to undo it. Saying what she wanted to say and saying it with energy had actually felt pretty good.
I have more questions. Who are the ancients, and how do you consult with people by shimmering? And who are the people you are consulting with, and how do you make this food taste so good?
Grace and Joy sighed. In their long years of assisting seekers, none had asked these questions. Most asked questions about truth and purpose and philosophy. But this young one was asking to play and how to cook and who they were. No one had questioned the sacrifice of the rulers. That was new, too. How could they explain the need for a mother's sacrifice to take care of her infant, or her father's sacrifice to go to war when necessary?
I heard that. Why did I hear that? I heard what you were thinking. This is too weird.
Thelma was getting worked up again.
They are way different. My mother didn't have a choice but to stay up with my little brother when he was sick, and my father didn't have a choice when our land was invaded. What has what food they eat got to do with anything, and why could I hear you think?
Thelma was definitely worked up. Suddenly, the little house disappeared around them, and they were in a large hall, and several people were sitting around in a circle. They looked regal by their bearing, but not by their attire. They were wearing normal clothes and did not look special at all, except in the way they looked proud in a humble way. Like their pride was based on something they possessed, but they knew they did not do anything to deserve it. And they were all smiling. One of them started chuckling. It was Joy.
You are a special young lady. Few people end up here at all, and even fewer end up here because they want to climb rocks and get their feet dirty.
How we love to see passion,
a woman added.
Especially when it is so imaginative. You want to know truths and recipes. Your desires are delightful.
All of the circle people were grinning and nodding. The woman walked over to her and handed her a basket of lilies.
Take these home to your parents. Your earthwalk is complete.
The hall faded, and Thelma was back on the path that she had been walking that morning. What an unsettling day. The only thing to do seemed to be to head home. She arrived at the castle within a few hours. The lilies looked as fresh and beautiful as when they had been given to her. She entered the kitchen and rang King Jeffers and Queen Bethany's bells as she headed to their chambers.
Daughter, right on schedule. Welcome home. You have been missed.
Her mother embraced her and her father kissed her forehead. Thelma wondered why they were acting like they hadn't seen her for months.
I was given these to give to you, Mother. Wait, what do you mean right on time?
Her mother turned white when she looked in the basket.
You were to return in 259 days, and tomorrow is the 259th day.
What's wrong, Mother? You are as white as the flowers. Is something wrong with the flowers?
Her father brought a chair for her mother.
Nothing is wrong. In fact, all is well. The prophecy is fulfilled. Our imprisonment is over.
Her father looked incredulous. Thelma brought him a chair. He looked like he might fall, too.
What happened? I just left this morning, but you're telling me months have passed?
When you cross into the forest, time changes. Long ago, wars waged on this planet. The ancients intervened and imprisoned the royals because they had done such a poor job of creating peace. They said they would send us lilies of peace when we sent them a pure lily and a ruler. No lilies grew within the palace grounds. In spite of our best efforts to become better leaders, we were never able to send a lily. Somehow, your earthwalk must have been that. What happened while you were gone?
Thelma looked sheepish.
Beats me. I met a woman named Grace. You said that I shouldn't be recognized, so when she asked who I was, I panicked, and the first thing I saw was a lily.
Queen Lily has quite a ring to it,
her mother said as she put a crown on Lily's head. her father had removed his crown and put it away until it would be needed.
Does this mean I still can't climb on the rocks and play outside?
The new Queen Lily asked, looking downhearted.
It means you are the ruler, and you make the rules.
Queen Lily grabbed her parents' hands as they ran out to the rocks. Today, they were purple, lavender, and magenta, and shaped just like thrones. We hope you enjoyed listening to this week's story. If you'd like to become a published author, hey, that's the purpose of this program. It's hard to get published unless you've been published, which makes no sense. So what we do here is we'll take your short story and publish it first as an ebook on the website. Then we turn it into an audiobook for the podcast. And when we've got enough stories to put together, we'll turn it all into an actual book that you can buy at a real store. If you'd like to submit a story, email it to contact@twopagesproject.com. We will be open to any type of story you want to send us. It's not just mysteries anymore, but sci-fi or fantasy or historical fiction or western or melodrama, whatever you want to write. Just submit your story for the audiobook treatment and publishing on our website. Don't forget to use the new email address, contact@twopagesproject.com. And don't forget to pass the show around because it's free and it's fun. There are a few rules. The list is available on the website, twopagesproject.com. Number two, Pages Project uses letters. So check that out. We'd also like to thank iTunes, the Google Play Store, and the Happy Hour Network for passing the show along. And don't forget to follow all the Coil shows on Pinterest or YouTube. And if you're interested in taking part in the audiobook process as a voice actor, use that same email address, contact@twopagesproject.com, and we'll see what we can do. So until next week, be safe and keep writing.